Hello. Well, here we are on the almost empty stage of the Fortune Theatre in Covent Garden. And this is just one of the theatres in London's West End that is temporarily closed. Later in the programme, I'll be putting the points raised by this discussion to the Minister for the Arts. But in the meantime, Ian Albury, why is the West End in such a bad way?
Well, the West End theatres are in a particularly bad situation at the moment because of the very discriminatory way that the government has levied VAT so that it affects the commercial theatre far worse than the grant-aided theatre because, in effect, in the commercial theatre, we pay VAT on 100% of our revenue, that is the total box office, while on the grant-aided theatre, which receives only perhaps, say, 40% of its revenue from the box office, they're only paying VAT on 40% of their revenue requirement, which means that we are even more penalised than we are at the moment in maintaining quality product in West End houses, because, after all, we're doing the same work as the subsidised theatre, yet we're taxed at over twice the rate.
Brian Ricks, do you find this is the reason? I mean, the only reason?
Well, it's one of the reasons, of course. But, I mean, VAT is only 15% of the ticket price. I think one of the other reasons is the actual cost of coming into the West End itself. Obviously, hotels cost a great deal now, the restaurants cost a great deal, and people who come into the West End do want the night out. And I think this is one of the contributory factors. But, of course, there are, even among this rather gloom and doom we're talking about, there still are at least half a dozen shows which are playing to enormous business. There always will be that. Mm. I think the success of... But the trouble is, the success is now confined to a limited number.
Miriam Karlin, VAT?
Well, I am a little worried about the overplaying of VAT. I think the over-publicising of it actually could possibly prove to be counterproductive. And although I agree with Ian totally in what he said, I also think that we've got to address ourselves to VAT right the way across the board, because when we get, if we do get any tourists coming into this country this year, they aren't only going to be thinking about the VAT on theatre prices, it's going to affect them as far as hotels are concerned, restaurants, and absolutely everything else. Mm-hmm. So I think that really VAT, 15%, is evil all the way along across the board.
I've got on every different kind of service. Could it perhaps be, I mean, it's all very well to sit here saying, oh, it's VAT and it's people don't want to come in, it's high prices. Could you perhaps, John Pick, could the theatre perhaps not be putting on the kind of product people want to come and see?
Well, I think it's very difficult for them because it's become so enormously expensive to put on a West End show that it's very difficult indeed to take any sort of risk at all, and plainly people try and put on that which will make a reasonable return over a longish period.
Can you give me some costs, or should I turn to either Ian Albury or Brian Ricks?
Well, I'd like to hear whether Brian agrees.
Yes, the costs.
Yes, costs, of course, are prohibitive nowadays compared to what they were. I mean, at 30 years ago, I put on Reluctant Heroes for £1,800. Mm. Today, the same play would cost something like £75,000. And that £75,000 you've actually got to get back. And that takes a long time because obviously your profit margin is smaller because you haven't been able to put up the seat prices commensurate with the cost of putting on the production. And with the tax on top of that as well, obviously people are taking 6, 9 months, 12 months in some cases to get their capital back. And of course this does make the whole thing much more difficult.
Why did Vincent Burke of the Society of West End Theatre say that there's been too much spread by the media about the doom and gloom of the theatre? I mean, how did we, the media, come to get blamed for this? You, the theatre people, must have started talking about it. Felix Barker?
Not, I think, in Fleet Street necessarily. It came, I think, from the theatre side, principally. We have seen it from the stalls, as it were, as a member of the audience, because one has seen a decline in the sort of plays one would like to see. We're seeing more and more comedies, light comedies, revivals, and things which aren't increasing the prestige of the theatre at all. And this is where we've begun to realise that this isn't just talk by the managers trying to line their own pockets, but it is a really genuine thing. And this is why now we, in Fleet Street, are concerned about this problem.
Sir Roy Shaw, can I come to you? Do you think that the decline of the West End theatres, or the decline of some of them, is because outside theatres, like the Lyric opened in Hammersmith not so long ago, there are very good theatres in Croydon, in Guildford, places like that. Do you think they are now satisfying the needs of the playgoers in that area so they don't bother to come up to the West End? And in fact, putting on better plays?
I don't think that's the reason for the West End's difficulties, because the people in Croydon and Hammersmith wouldn't necessarily make the journey into the West End. It's increasingly expensive and difficult to do so. I think we're narrowing the focus of this discussion too much. It's not just VAT, it's not just rising costs. The theatre is in a general state of crisis, television, the old enemy, is taking audiences. Also, young people tend to go to the theatre rather than to the cinema rather than the theatre.
I not just butt in there? Let me just go across, if I may, to Frank Kelly from the British Tourist Authority. Do you think the theatre's outpricing itself for tourists? Do tourists go as much, those that come here?
Yes, I think they do, and I think there's a great deal of talk about the fact that tourists aren't coming. We've had a very good year in tourists. There's been a drop in American tourists, but overall we've kept up the year before's figures, and we've had an increase in revenue, and we're going to do well again this year. And about 40% of tourists surveyed say that they think that theatre prices are greater than their prices at home, but in the main, some 60% of tourists say they're going to go to the theatre while they're here. There are some 3.5 million
As often
million
as they
people.
Used to go? Because it's said that the theatre here has been rather complacent in the West End and relied an awful lot on tourists, and once the number of tourists dropped...
But the number of tourists really haven't dropped. I mean, they may not be going to the theatre, they may be a little bit more selective in what they go to because prices are higher.
Why do we mention such high prices here in the West End when in American theatre they seem to be much, much higher, and yet people go over there? Broadway is enjoying a boom at the moment.
Yes, price is mainly critical, of course, in the home market. It's not critical in the tourist market. Our experience is that price is not a factor. That it's an important factor, and of course our product is price sensitive, but much more important than that is the quality of product. And the experience that I think Frank is talking about in the terms of the drop of tourists from the States, that is not the critical factor in our experience. Mm. It's that they used to come 3.5 times in a fortnight. Well, they now only come once or twice.
All right, fine. But in fact, you just said the critical part is the home market. Is that because, I did some research into this, 40 to 50% of all theatre tickets sold in London go to foreigners, the majority of British bought tickets seem to go to people in the provinces. Londoners seem to buy very few tickets in comparison to anybody else. Is that because of the product?
It's partly because of the product, it's partly because of the awareness of the product, it's partly because of the quality of the product, it's partly because of the marketing of the product. And it's a mixed bag of tricks.
All right, Michael Imerson, you're a literary agent. What can be done to stop this rot if this rot is there?
Well, I think the managers have now got to start being more enterprising and spread their nets much wider. They can't go on relying on reviving old plays, doing comedies, as Felix said, which are very thin, insubstantial, so the audience goes away and the day later have forgotten what they've actually seen. They don't seem to me to be really looking for new and interesting plays. I had a play called The Elephant Man, which was performed at the Hampstead Theatre Club. It got very respectable notices, and not a single West End manager would touch it. It then went to America.
What were the reasons given for that?
They said, oh no, it's a serious play, it's about a man who's deformed, we can't have a play that's like that, the audience won't be entertained. Mm. We want something light. Went to America, won the Tony Awards, the best play of the year, is making more money than any straight play in America, and so I then offered it again to the West End managers. Not one will touch it. It is now going to be done at the National Theatre.
Brian Ricks, well, I think you must answer that briefly.
Yes, I would like to, because our management brought in two plays from Hampstead, Clouds and Bodies, both of which did enormous business. We also put on a play about a quadriplegic called Whose Life Is It Anyway, which has done enormous business at the West End. And indeed, I think that we felt The Elephant Man wasn't appropriate for a West End audience. Although it may have been a huge success on Broadway, I think this would be our feeling about it.
So, Roy, why do we give so much money to the theatre? I mean, do people really care about it, or is it just those of us here or people who are in the profession? Does the great British public really care about the theatre?
A minority of the great British public does, but it's a minority that supports all the arts, music, visual arts, and so on. And it's like education. Education isn't valued by the whole population, but we decide that it's good for the country, and it certainly is. I think the emphasis on the tourist role is valuable only as a financial argument. As a financial argument, it's overwhelming. We get much more back from the tourists than we spend on arts subsidy. But I'm glad of the emphasis in this discussion of catering for the home audience, the London audience and the regional audience. And
but clearly, we're not, so why are we spending money on it? I mean, why not put the money somewhere else? They might want an amusement park or more cinemas. Why give 60 millions of our money to subsidise theatres?
We don't give 60 millions of our money. We only give 60 millions to subsidise the whole damn lot.
OK, it's a lot of money.
Yeah. But Because the theatre is an inescapable and important part of our lives.
Of whose, though? Miriam Karlin.
I think understand why you keep on saying, Alan, why do we give so much money? Yes. Why is there so much subsidy? What we are feeling, all of us, I'm sure, that we are getting a pathetically small little nibble of the general gâteau that is going. And in point of fact, I know that it is 0.69 of the general public expenditure is actually spent. 0.69% of the general expenditure is actually given to the arts. And I think that is pathetic.
But given the climate at the moment, given the fact that we are all being told by the government, you must stand on your own feet, that everybody must...
We are being told stand on our own feet, and we are being told all the time that we should go elsewhere for money. We can't give money. In point of fact, it's the Treasury that is not giving the money. One Mr. Caff laid himself open to it all. He gave a lecture last year, he's a Treasury official, and said that he thought that the arts were over-subsidised, and he quoted this figure that I've just given you, because he said that it's gone up to 0.69 from 0.47 in 1968. Isn't that wonderful?
But John, let me just ask John Pick, and I know you can all come back on this. Isn't it very low in the priority stakes at the moment when old people's homes are being closed, hospitals are being closed, money just isn't there? Isn't the theatre really very, very low on anybody's shopping list of priorities? John?
But it shouldn't be, because it's about the value. I mean, it's the reason for being alive. There's no point in keeping people alive and keeping them healthy and giving them education unless there's something there to live for. And the theatre is one of the means by which people are given values and are given their lives are given some importance.
Felix Barker, you have a theory that you think could perhaps help solve some of these cost prices.
Yes, it's a very daring one and a very difficult one to implement, but I'd like to put it to the Arts Council as a possibility. Maybe we discuss VAT for a second, because I think it's
involved. Very, very quickly, because
yes,
I want to move on.
I don't want to talk much about VAT, but it seems to me one way in which we could possibly... My concern as a critic is keeping up of standards and the quality of what is going on in the theatre. It is quite obvious to me that if managers are frightened off, are being taxed as they feel it out of existence, they must always play safe. While they play safe, we're never going to get experiment and real excitement in the theatre. So how can we possibly change it so that managers feel that they can afford to put on better things? Take a chance. And my answer is that VAT should only be put on frivolous plays, unimportant plays, and that plays should be vetted by the Arts Council, and those which seem to have a sufficient standard should be exempt from VAT. Now, I know this is... I can see everyone furious and worried about this, because it's a terribly subjective thing. How can you possibly decide what is of cultural value, what is of artistic value and the rest? But I still think that it's one way in which we could make managers feel that they had money to...
Well, it's an amazing statement. Let me put it to Sir Roy.
That's so amazing. We did it in the war. We had an entertainment tax in the Second World War, and we exempted serious plays from it. Somebody had to decide which were the serious
plays.
Who makes the decision? In fact, that was a non-profit distributing company that actually made that. You made the decision when you put the play on.
Yeah.
You actually formed a company that became, as it were, a charity. But that, in fact, was a cheat, which was used by numbers of managers who were actually commercial managers.
Yes.
And there was always a management fee could be collected.
I hope we ended this discussion on a more positive note than some of our gloom has suggested. I recently heard, I don't know whether it's true and I don't really care, that the Japanese word for disaster also meant opportunity. Mm. Well, the theatre's in a slight disaster condition at the moment, but there is an opportunity to rethink our direction. One of the things that's already happening is, Ian has mentioned the cooperation between the subsidised theatre and the commercial theatre. This has developed a good deal. Several of the commercial theatres in London are playing plays which originated in the subsidised theatre. Splendid. We took the risk. They then make them more widely available. That's a kind of partnership which I would like to think can develop.
Miriam, could Felix Barker's idea work?
Well, I find it quite frightening, Felix, in that you are literally saying, bring back the Lord Chamberlain.
That's it. That's right.
And
those
days are gone, please, but never to come back. I mean, you're going to have a great... panel of people sitting, vetting every show, and are you going to have, and there's going to be such differences of opinion, and you can very well, if what you said were to come into being, one would have somebody putting on a tits and bums show, and then they would stick in some little bit which made it of some artistic value.
You two, sorry, time is running out. I'd like very quickly to say, John, what would you like, the one thing you think must be done now to revive the theatre?
I think greater cooperation between subsidised and commercial, that has to go on improving in the near future. Secondly, I'd like the much more imaginative thinking about marketing, which we've not talked enough about.
All right, thank you.
I would like to see quicker decisions by the management of theatres on marketing proposals put to them and to get on with the job and to all the time say the theatre is good so that that is what is reported overseas and not what some theatre managements are saying how bad it is, which makes the headlines in the Canadian and American papers.
Yeah.
We're killing ourselves.
Sir Roy, you want to say something very briefly?
I would just like to see the Cabinet encouraged to go to the theatre more often so they discover what they're missing and what a lot of the country is missing through their meanness.
All right, thank you very much, Sir Roy.
Minister,
Miriam?
To carry out his original pre-election manifesto would be lovely.
And my thing is no tax on ideas in the theatre.
Right, thank you all very much indeed. And in fact, I must now say thank you for coming along here, because I am going to interview the minister and will put all the points that you have raised here. Thank you very much indeed. Minister, in that discussion, Ian Aubrey, indeed many of the others, but he particularly said that VAT was the arch villain of the theatre's woes. And in fact, the commercial sector is taxed at over twice the rate of the subsidised sector. Why is that?
Well, of course, VAT doesn't help. And I would be delighted, personally, to see the theatre and all the arts, indeed, free of VAT. So unfortunately, it's not for me to decide. That's a matter for the other Chancellor, the Chancellor of the Exchequer. But I think they'd be making a great mistake if they took the view that abolish VAT and the theatre's problems are going to be solved. They aren't. Because the theatre has all sorts of problems arising from inflation, from change of social habits, from the fact that people are reluctant to go to the theatre, whether the product is right, whether the selling is right. And what I would like to see is a much more positive approach, which did come out from time to time in the discussions from John Gillam and others, so that the theatre people improve their marketing, that they change the times, say, when plays are put on to suit people better, that they make it easier to get tickets, that they produce family reductions, all these things. They've got to go out and sell to the people, as they're doing on Broadway.
Some of them are actually trying that, though. I mean, in Aubrey's, he's got a show where the child gets in free if it brings an adult or something like that. But that's still not the answer to my question. Why are they taxed at over twice the rate of the subsidised
theatre? Oh, I don't think that's true at all. There's a general tax which is the same for each. But, of course, the subsidised theatre has the advantage of the subsidy, which will take into account the tax. So I'm afraid that was a false point. I don't think he understood the mathematics of it.
But surely then it does mean that the commercial theatre is bearing the full brunt for every single seat of VAT.
Yes, I'm very sympathetic towards the commercial theatre, who after all don't get anything. The National gets about 4 million. The Arts Council in general spends 17 million on the theatre, the subsidised theatre, in London, 10 million outside. And my sympathies are all with the commercial theatre, but they've got to make more efforts to bring their products to the people.
Well, now, Miriam Karlin said that the theatre is getting a particularly small slice of the whole gâteau of help. 0.69% of general public expenditure is spent on the arts.
Yeah.
Why is so little spent?
Mm. Well, the reason why they get so little of the gâteau is, I'm afraid, something to do with our culture, and that we don't give the arts a high enough priority. Budgets rarely reflect what the priorities of the nation are. And one of my jobs as arts minister is to try to persuade people that the arts are as essential to happiness as, say, an education service or a health service. But we haven't got there yet, I'm afraid.
But are they as essential to happiness? I mean, are they more important, as I asked in the discussion, than hospital beds and education?
I don't think one could say they were more important, but they are as important. Because after all, what is life about? It's about certain material needs and wants, and then about fulfilling spiritual aspirations and values. And that's where the arts are so important, because they appeal to the higher faculties of man. And if you're going to have a good society, you want to have a flourishing spiritual life. And for many people, their perception of the spiritual comes through the arts today rather than through religion.
Well, is the fact, though, that they are getting so little part of the general government policy at the moment, which we're told about, is you will stand on your own two feet, you know, you must. Industry has told this, everybody else. Is this happening to the arts, and particularly the theatre? You do it?
No, it isn't. In fact, the figure that was given, about £60 million, of course, that was referring to the Arts Council grant, but my grant for the arts and libraries is £350 million. And I'm glad to be able to tell you that the grant next year will not only be increased in money terms, but in real terms it should be comparable directly with the grant last year, so that at this time of very great cutting in expenditure, the arts, through the Arts Council, will be doing very well from central government support.
Will it be as large a grant as you would like to see?
Oh, no. I would like to spend the whole budget, if necessary, on the arts. But what I want to make clear is the government supports public subsidy for the arts, that will continue, and if we want much extra money, we've got to get it from the private sector, and so I'm putting my principles into practice, and I'm spending a great deal of my time going around the country, speaking to people, putting the case for private patronage to them, and we're having a tremendous success. The other day in Manchester, 500 people came to a dinner in order to support the local art gallery and pay £500 each, and in return they're able to borrow pictures from the gallery. Now, it's that sort of positive scheme we want to get over, instead of sitting round, as was said on the programme, and moaning and whinging. That's hopeless, and that never got anyone anywhere.
Wouldn't it be better, though, perhaps to give tax relief to people who wanted to invest in the theatre? Has that been thought of?
Well,
tax
of course,
relief
yes,
for investors, private
there,
investors?
There are plenty of tax reliefs for companies. You can make covenants also as an individual. And here I'm trying to bring this to people's attention, the great opportunities there are, not only for helping companies like Covent Garden, but at the local level, local theatres, link up with local industry. And there's an enormous job of selling to be done here. And we'll also consider, in the Chancellor's budget and in subsequent budgets, what changes might help in this way.
Well, as I speak to you now, there are six theatres that are dark, i.e. they are shut, although they're costing money to keep going because people have to be retained in case a show comes in again. Yeah. Can you do anything for those at the moment?
Well, we've got 29 commercial theatres in the West End. We've got six subsidised theatres. I regret if any theatre is closed, but I don't think if five of them are closed, that really is a major disaster. And what I'm afraid about the discussion on the theatre, and it came out in your programme, Miriam Karlin, she's a brilliant actress and she's got a very acute mind. I mean, she made the point that if people go on moaning the whole time and play the thing down, they'll create the very conditions which they are against. So let's be positive. Let's say, yes, of course things are difficult, but how can we put them right? The government will do its part, but the government can't do it all, and other people have got to help in this way.
Yeah, but surely, I mean, there must be a debate. There must be debate about it. That's gone wrong with other industries. I mean, this must be uppermost. Couldn't you help now, immediately, by getting the VAT removed? Wouldn't that give them a little ray of hope?
As I say, if I were Chancellor of the Exchequer, I'd cancel VAT on the theatre tomorrow. I'm not. I have managed to get them quite a reasonable grant this year. Now we must get more money for the private sector, and in the theatre, people must come forward with new ideas for selling their seats, for the times of performances, etc. And of course, anything I can do to help in that sphere, I and my office are at the disposal of the West End Theatre.
Right. Minister, thank you very much. Well, there we are. The debate no doubt will rage on, but that's all there's time for from Thames Report, so good night.